Welcome back home, COP family. To prioritize your safety, please listen closely as we remind you of these health and safety protocols required by the Department of Health and the IATF. All COP campuses will be thoroughly disinfected before members are allowed to come in. Before entering the COP premises, always wear a face mask and a face shield. Please undergo temperature scanning. Use the disinfecting mats. While inside COP, use the sanitizing stations every 20 minutes. Take note of our social distancing markers around the campus. Always follow the signs and maintain the flow. Use the foot markers when queuing. Use the assigned stairs when going up or down. When finding your assigned seat or exiting the auditorium, please approach our friendly ushers and they will gladly assist you. Please remember that you can only sit on chairs with a red marker. A safety officer will always be present to assist you for any concerns regarding the mentioned protocols. We're doing our best to help keep you safe. So all you need to do is seek God and focus on His Word.
Welcome back home, COP family. Wow, that feels good to say. We are back in live worship services, and it's wonderful to be able to say, see you face to face. We have 5 weekend schedules. Saturday at 6 p.m., Sunday at 7:30 a.m., 10 a.m., 12:30 p.m., and 3 p.m. We'll finally get to worship, pray, and learn the Word all together again in God's house. But how about the kids and seniors who can't attend services yet? Don't worry, lots of options are available. Everyday Jesus and Senior Moments to Remember are still available online. And our South Saturday drive-in service at 7:30 a.m. is a lot of fun and still available. And our services will still be on Facebook and YouTube. For more information and latest updates, keep checking our social media pages. COP family, let's go to the house of the Lord.
Let's go to the house of the Lord.
Welcome back home, COP family. To prioritize your safety, please listen closely as we remind you of these health and safety protocols required by the Department of Health and the IATF. All COP campuses will be thoroughly disinfected before members are allowed to come in. Before entering the COP premises, always wear a face mask and a face shield. Please undergo temperature scanning. Use the disinfecting mats. While inside COP, use the sanitizing stations every 20 minutes. Take note of our social distancing markers around the campus. Always follow the signs and maintain the flow. Use the foot markers when queuing. Use the assigned stairs when going up or down. When finding your assigned seat or exiting the auditorium, please approach our friendly ushers and they will gladly assist you. Please remember that you can only sit on chairs with a red marker. A safety officer will always be present to assist you for any concerns regarding the mentioned protocols. We're doing our best to help keep you safe. So all you need to do is seek God and focus on His Word.
Welcome back home, COP family. Wow, that feels good to say. We are back in live worship services, and it's wonderful to be able to say, see you face to face. We have 5 weekend schedules. Saturday at 6 p.m., Sunday at 7:30 a.m., 10 a.m., 12:30 p.m., and 3 p.m. We'll finally get to worship, pray, and learn the Word all together again in God's house. But how about the kids and seniors who can't attend services yet? Don't worry, lots of options are available. Everyday Jesus and Senior Moments to Remember are still available online. And our South Saturday drive-in service at 7:30 a.m. is a lot of fun and still available. And our services will still be on Facebook and YouTube. For more information and latest updates, keep checking our social media pages. COP family, let's go to the house of the Lord.
Let's go to the house of the Lord.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our Saturday night worship service. We are glad to see you all again in God's house.
Yeah.
Hello to all of our wonderful campuses there in Maine, South, North, here in East, Bulacan, Pampanga, and Cavite. Thank you so much for your faithfulness in God's house. Let's all stand up. And we are going to be praying for all our beloved young people. COP, how do we pray? Fervently and with joy. Let's lift our voices to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we come into your wonderful presence, Lord God, tonight. Once again, Father, we thank you, Lord God, that this is the day that you have made and that we shall rejoice in it. Thank you so much, Father God, that you have brought us, Lord, into your wonderful house. Thank you, Jesus, that you are walking among us in the midst, Lord, of your congregation. And Father, we thank you, God, for the Holy Spirit is ushering us into your wonderful throne, that we can come to you boldly, Lord, and with confidence in Jesus' name. Father, right now we are so grateful, Lord, that we can be able, Father, to lift up, God, our young people. You have blessed us, Father, with good young people. And we are so thankful, Father God, for all of our teenagers, for all of our beloved young people. Thank you so much, oh God, that you have promised to them in accordance with your word that they have a great future. Thank you, Lord God, for blessing our next generation in Jesus' name. That you have promised, Father, that our young people, Lord God, that our children are going to be mighty in the land, Father. Right now, Father, in the midst, Lord God, of pandemic, Lord, this time, Lord, there are quite challenges among our young people. So, Father, we lift up to you, God, our young people, Father. They have been in quarantine and they have been there at lockdown at home. Right now, that is going to be opening up, Father. I pray, God, for our young people that they have the desire always to be in God's house, oh God. That they will always seek you, Lord. That they will always seek your very presence, oh God. That they will long to dwell into your house in Jesus' name. Thank you so much, oh God, that our young people will live right and will live righteous in accordance with your word. And I pray, Father God, that it is their desire, Father, their ruling goal, God, to please you, Lord, that they will live holy before the Lord. And that we pray, Father, that their hearts are to be inclined in God's word and in his presence, that there will always be longing to read your word, that every day, Father, they will meditate on your word and seek your very presence, O God. That even, Father, in their situation these days, Lord, in the stage of their lives, God, that they're making many decisions, Lord, we pray, Father, for wisdom and guidance, O God, in their decisions. Father, I pray, God, for the wisdom and the Holy Spirit, Father, to dwell upon their lives, and so that, God, they will make right decisions upon their lives for their future, Lord. And God, we thank you, Lord God, that your name be glorified, Lord, as you bless our young people, Father, with wisdom and guidance, oh God, as they do the right thing, oh God, as they do the right choices in life. Father, we thank you, God, that your name be glorified as they continue, Father, to seek you, as they continue, Father, to serve God. Thank you so much, oh God, that your name be glorified, Lord, in their lives. Lord, as they become a testimony of God's goodness, Lord, and faithfulness, Father. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Jesus is the light of this world, and the unfolding of his word gives light. Jesus is the Christ. Not a way, a truth, and one way of life.
At COP, we know that like the apostles, we are to preach the gospel publicly and from house to house. It is a privilege to be in your homes sharing the gospel.
At COP, we know a pastor is to teach the Word of God, enabling us to live lives that please the Lord.
At COP, we know we are to preach the gospel to the poor, bringing them to what Jesus called life and life more abundantly.
At COP, we heal the sick in Jesus' name, and our God is with us even to the end of the age.
At COP, we know that the message is the gospel. We love it, we live it, and we preach it. It is the good news, and it is the power of God unto salvation for those who believe.
At COP, our eyes are on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. We don't worship worship, we don't worship fellowship, we worship Jesus.
At COP, we know that we have been called by God to be priests. We are to serve Him. We don't live in our own little world. We serve Him fervently until every lost person is found. We will build 200 churches across our land and across the world in the next 20 years.
At COP, we know every member has been given the Great Commission, so we joyfully work while it is yet day, seeing people born again, baptized in water, baptized in the Holy Spirit, and learning to live for God.
At COP, we know that we are to bear fruit and not to gather fruit. There is no shortage of people that need to hear the gospel. Our joy is to go to the harvest field and then bring the harvest field to the Lord.
At COP, we know we are to fill His house with His praise. We praise the Lord. We praise Him for who He is and what He does. If it's not about Him, it's not praise.
At COP, we know that the tithe is not about obedience to the law. It is before the law, during the law, and even Jesus taught tithing. It is our joy to bring the whole tithe into the storehouse to the Lord.
At COP, we know prosperity is about trusting our Heavenly Father for everything we need. No fear of debt, no fear of poverty, no fear of people. Our Father is our provider.
At COP, we know that Jesus taught us to pray, Our Father. That means that we are part of a great family of God across this world. When one part of that family needs help, it is our role freely give as we have freely received.
At COP, we know God's grace abounds to us, teaching us to say no to sin and to work hard for Him.
Savior, I thank God. Oh, like ashes in the wind. Welcome so long to my old friends. Burden and bitterness, you just can't keep them moving. Oh, you ain't welcome here. From now till I walk the streets of gold, I sing about you, save my soul. This wayward son has found his way back.
Forever free, I'm not the same. I thank the Master. I thank the Master. Amen. Good evening, COP, and welcome to our Saturday evening worship service. Hello to our wonderful campuses and fruitful branches. We are just so glad to see you in God's house tonight. Now, if this is your first time or you've been here before, we just want to remind everyone that we're going to continue to follow government guidelines and regulations. So please do observe and maintain social distancing all throughout the service. Let's always wear our face mask, our face shield, and please do help us out by completing the contact tracing form. So COP, are you ready to worship the Lord some more?
Yeah.
Let's give God all the glory.
These hands.
we're going to have our first prayer time. We're having a special night tonight called Psalms We Sing, Psalms We Pray. And we will have three prayer times throughout the evening. Our first will be prayer for safety. Our second will be prayer for financial security. And our third will be prayer for rest. And we will start with prayer for safety. So we're going to look at Psalm 61. How do we know that Psalm 61 is a prayer? Well, in verse 1, it says, "Hear my cry, O God, listen to my prayer." So I think it's pretty safe to assume that Psalm 61 is a prayer. And we should know that there are lots of different kinds of psalms in the book of Psalms. We sing them all, but some are, this is really echoey to me. Does it sound really echoey to you guys? It sounds really loud and echoey to me, yeah. A little bit of a problem here. There are psalms that are for teaching. There are psalms that are for Sabbath day, psalms that are for weddings, psalms that are praise, and there are also psalms which are prayers, such as this one. And David said that he is praying this prayer from the ends of the earth. You know what that means? When he was praying that prayer in Psalm 61, he wasn't in church. Did you know that problems come in our life? Most often, when problems come, we're not in church. Most often, when problems come, we're either at home, or we're sitting in the doctor's office, or we're having a business problem or situation arise. So problems happen here, there, and everywhere. And the really, really good thing that we know is that no matter where we are, we can cry to the Lord, and he will hear and answer our prayers.
Amen.
Hello.
Amen.
No matter where we are. So Psalm 61 is a prayer, and he's praying it from the ends of the earth. But what is it a prayer for? What was his problem? We get a clue in verse 2, because it says, "Lead me to the rock that is higher than I." Oh, so David is praying a prayer for safety. He wants safety. He's got some situation going on where he wants safety in his life, and he's asking God, "God, would you just lead me to a rock that's higher than I?" And you know what? I really love those kind of prayers. When we pray, "God, lead me to a rock that's higher than I. So there's absolutely nothing that I can do about this. There's nothing that I can do about the solution. God, when you put me on that rock that is higher than I, for sure, you're going to get all the glory because I could not have done that by myself." I like that kind of prayer because there are so many times, isn't it, that we have a tendency when we pray, then later on we just excuse it. Like, oh, what if you woke up with a sore throat and a fever? Oh, and you call your pastor, "Oh, I have a sore throat and a fever. What am I gonna do?" And you guys pray together, and then by lunchtime, it's gone, and you're going on your day, and you say, "Oh, I guess it was nothing after all. It just resolved itself. It was okay, pala. I'm fine, pala. I want people to pray prayers, Lord, lead me to the rock that's higher than I." Where God, we give God all the glory because only he could have done that. Amen. And you know that word lead me to the rock that's higher than I? That word lead actually means, of course it means direct a person's activity, but it also means to create opportunity. So God, would you just create an opportunity for me to be safe? Would you create an opportunity for me to be safe physically, financially? Would you give me clients that I never dreamed would ever be my clients? Lord, would you just open up opportunities for me and give me these opportunities? That is his prayer. Now, that is one clue that we have that he is praying a prayer for safety. There's another clue that we have that he's praying a prayer for safety, and that's in verse 3, because it says, "For you have been my refuge, a strong tower against the foe." What's a foe? An enemy. Anybody here have an enemy? Anybody? Who has an enemy? If you don't yet have an enemy, live. And later on, you will have. It will be provided for you. Because that's part of life. But David had so many enemies that enemies and foes became part, it became one of the main themes in the book of Psalms. Because no matter what was going on in David's life, he just kept singing to the Lord about it. And he would even sing to the Lord about his enemies and his foes. All right, he had a problem. He needed safety. So he came to the Lord and prayed. Now, what was David's idea of how God should solve his problem? To me, verse 4 is one of the funniest verses in the Bible. Why is it funny? Well, let's read it. "I long to dwell in your tent forever and to take refuge in the shelter of your wings." Why is that a funny verse? Why is that the funniest verse in the Bible? Well, there's two things that are very funny about it. For one thing, David was at that time the king. Where did the king live? He lived in a cedar palace. Oh, when you go to Israel with us, you get to go to David's palace. Well, the remains of David's palace. Well, you don't see the cedar anymore because I guess that was lining the inside. But all the outside of that palace, it is strong rocks and boulders. It is a fortress. And David said, "I long to dwell in your tent forever." Hey, wait a minute. This is why it's funny. He'd rather dwell in a tent for safety when he had a palace of rock and cedar? Why? What's so special about the tent? Because it's God's tent where the ark of the presence of the Lord dwelt. Yeah. And if you are in a tent, if God is in that tent, it is safer than the biggest fortress with all the cedar and all the rock in the whole universe. It is safer to be in the presence of God. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. But the second thing that is really funny about that verse, he said, "And let me find refuge in the shelter of your wings." Can anybody tell me what are wings made out of?
Feathers.
A tent and feathers. Can anybody think of any substance which might be stronger than a feather? Can you think of any substance in this world that might be stronger than a feather? Yeah, let's just start listing them. Steel, rocks, wood, adobe. One of my students said adobe would be stronger. Oh, I remember. We lived in an adobe house. And pastor was trying to hang pictures for me. And he broke 3 drill bits on his drill, trying to get the nail into the wall to hang pictures for me in that house. Adobe would be strong. But David said, "Lord, I want to dwell in refuge under your wings." Wow. A tent more than a cedar palace? Feathers more than adobe? What's the difference? God is there.
Amen.
Under his wings.
Yeah.
It's all about being in the Lord. Amen. Our safety comes being in God. And you know what? When you snuggle up under those wings of the Lord, remember, there's healing in his wings. Amen. Amen. The Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in his wings. Amen. Amen. So it leads us to a time of prayer right now. So let's all stand up together. And we are going to have a beautiful time of prayer for ourselves, for our families, for our loved ones, and let's pray for safety. Amen. You know, when you see on Facebook all the time, people will comment, stay safe, be safe, stay safe. That's really an issue right now. People want safety. So let's all lift up. How do we pray, COP?
Fervently and joyfully.
So let's lift up our voices and pray for safety.
Our Heavenly Father,
Heavenly Father, Heavenly Father,
thank you so much.
We thank you, God. We bless you. Let every
There is safety in His presence.
Amen. Amen.
All right, you may be seated for just a moment. And sweetheart, it was an adobe-covered house.
Oh, okay. What do I know?
The outside of the house was the old adobe blocks from the 1970s. The inside of the house, the owner of the house's relative owned a concrete company, and everything was poured concrete, as in everything was poured concrete. In order to hang a picture, we had to get what they call a hammer drill in order just to get something into the wall. It was amazing. I want you to open your Bibles, please, to 2 Chronicles chapter 1. 2 Chronicles 1. I want to finish up what I started on last week for Father's Day. And the reason I'm doing more Father's Day today is, well, it's still Father's Day. And all the fathers said, okay, we can have Mother's Day every day. We can have Father's Day every day. When Shasha was little, we always had unbirthdays. Daddy, today is my unbirthday. Okay, we'll go celebrate. It's your unbirthday. But I went very short last week because I wanted to give plenty of time for Pastor Bong and Pastor Duke as they taught you on being a father of small children and being a father of young teenagers. I want to continue to look at being a father of adult children. 2 Chronicles chapter 1, beginning with verse 8. And Solomon said to God, "You have shown great and steadfast love to David my father and have made me king in his place." 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 6 and 7. And Solomon answered, "You have shown great kindness to your servant, my father David. Because he was faithful to you and righteous and upright in heart, you have continued this great kindness to him and have given him a son to sit on his throne to this very day." Solomon, even as a young man, was wise enough to recognize he did not become the next king of Israel because he was the next in line. The next in line was Adonijah that tried to take the kingdom away from him. He was not made king because he was the smartest or the brightest or the best. He had a legacy that God gave to him. Because of the life David had lived, God gave an opportunity to Solomon. Everybody say, my life, ulitanatan, my life and my lifestyle will create an opportunity for the next generation. Solomon was wise enough to recognize this opportunity was given him, not because of anything he had done, but this opportunity to be the king of Israel had been given to him because of the life that his father David had lived. Now Solomon didn't follow in that same example. He did not live a life that left a legacy for the next generation. God chose no successor for David. And because God chose no successor, Rehoboam became king, and you know the rest of the story. But David lived a life that left a spiritual legacy, and that legacy was an opportunity. Now, David was not a perfect man. We know that. You walk up to the average person on the street, and you ask them what they know about King David, and they kind of smile and laugh and go, "Ha ha, Bathsheba, adultery." Yeah, you're right. David had a real bad season in his life. He was a peeping Tom, he was an adulterer, he was a murderer. But most scholars say that this bad season was only about a few months long. Everybody say a few months. And beloved, please, one bad season does not define a life. Everybody say one bad season does not define a life. David had one really bad season in his life. But otherwise, he lived a wonderfully committed life to God. But he wasn't a perfect man, and he was not a perfect father, especially in his earlier days. Grabe, we have at least 20 or 21 recorded children of King David. 20 or 21. We know that the first was Amnon, who was killed by his third-in-line brother Absalom because he raped his younger sister Tamar. We know that the second was Daniel, born of Abigail, but we know nothing about him. We know the third was Absalom, and we know all about him. And the fourth is Adonijah, who tried to steal the kingdom away from Solomon. Now, you look at these guys and you go, why don't any of them have the spirit of their father David? Why don't any of them have the insides that their father David had? because David didn't raise them. He was not exactly a perfect father. 1 Chronicles 27, verse 32, New International Version. Jonathan, David's uncle, was a counselor, a man of insight, and a scribe. Jehiel, son of Hakmoni, took care of the king's son. Everybody say, Jehiel. Jehiel was the Yahya. Jehiel raised the king's sons. David didn't raise his sons. David was busy being king, and David was busy off fighting his battles, and David didn't pour his life into his sons. Now, dads, straight up talk. If you don't raise your children don't have your spirit. I didn't hear you. If you don't raise your children don't have your spirit. They don't have your character. They don't have your insides in them. They have the insides of the Yahya that raised them. And this is the problem with David's older sons. Now, evidently, things had changed around by the time Solomon is born. Because when you read through Proverbs, you see that Solomon was raised rather differently. Solomon repetitively talks about walking in the wisdom of his father, listening to his father, the words that his father passed on to him, and many, many, many of the teachings of Proverbs you find flowing out of David's words in Chronicles and in Kings, and you look at it in Samuel, you see David had a heart, and you see those words coming out again in the book of Proverbs. David had poured his heart and life into King Solomon. But he wasn't a perfect man, and he wasn't a perfect father, but he was a man after God's own heart. 1 Samuel 13, verse 14, "But now your kingdom shall not continue. The Lord has sought out a man after his own heart." Acts 13, verse 22, "And when he was removed, he raised up David to be their king, of whom he testified and said, 'I have found in David, the son of Jesse, a man after my heart, who will do all my will.'" Now, David wasn't a perfect man, but he had a heart that always brought him back to God. David wasn't a perfect father, but he had a heart that would always do what God wanted. Everybody say, do the will of God. Hey, you look at that, who will do all my will. David didn't mind the sacrifice. David did not mind the pain and the suffering that he had to go through to drive back the borders of Israel and see the people of God receive all the promised land that he had made to Abraham, their forefather. David didn't mind that. David said, you know, God, if you want it done, bless God, let's go do it in Jesus' name. This is who he was. But now there were three words that built the legacy of an opportunity. We saw it in 1 Kings 3, verse 6. "Because he walked before you in faithfulness." In what? In what? Now that word faithfulness in the Hebrew means reliable. Everybody say reliable. Dads, if you will be a person that God looks at as reliable. As what? You be a man that God can count on. You will leave a legacy of an opportunity to your children. The second word, in righteousness, because he walked before you in faithfulness or reliability. Second word, in righteousness. Righteousness doesn't mean holiness or perfection. It means you do the right thing. You do the what? Now, sometimes David did the wrong thing, but when Nathan the prophet corrected him on it, David did the right thing and repented. Are we still here? The nice thing about a bad decision is you can go back and make a right decision. And David was righteous. David was a man who was going to do the right thing. No matter what it cost him, David would do the right thing. You read through all the things that we've been reading in morning devotions about David. And you read through how when Joab killed those two innocent men, and David would stand up in front of everybody and show them that he was innocent of these men's blood, that he had nothing to do with it. He said, this guy went and did this himself. This was wrong. And the people recognized that, no, David's a man who's going to do the right thing. And thirdly, he was upright. Again, verse 6, 1 Kings 3, "Because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and uprightness." Uprightness means sincerity. Everybody say, be real. With David, what you saw is what you got. Everybody say, what you see is what you get. There's no phony, there's no facade. Love him or hate him, David is who he is. Now, dads, straight talk. We can't lay out the destiny for our children. We can't build their futures for them. We want to, but we can't build their futures for them. We can't lay out their destinies for them. But we can live a life of being reliable in the eyes of God. We can live a life of doing what's right in the eyes of God. We can live a life of being sincere in the eyes of God. And because we are reliable, because we do what's right, and because we are sincere, God will look at our children and God will give them an opportunity. God will give them a what? Say it again. And just like in Solomon's day, he had an opportunity. Now, what he did with it was his decision. How he lived it out was his decision. But Solomon recognized, I have this opportunity because the life of my father and the life that he lived before God. Now, dads, we can't make our children's destiny. We wish we could make sure that everything was good for them for the rest of their life. We can't do that. We're going to go to heaven. But we can live a life that God would look upon them and say, for the sake of my servant Juan, I'm going to give them this opportunity. For the sake of my servant Juan, I'm going to give that child this opportunity. Yeah, they're going to have to make their own decisions about it, but I will lay out this opportunity. The greatest inheritance that we can ever give our children is not a big hunk of property in the province or, you know, 15 condos in Manila. The greatest legacy, the greatest inheritance we can give our children is a spiritual heritage that causes God to lay out opportunities before their lives. And everybody said, all right, that's my offering thought today. Would you put your tithe in the red envelopes, please? Put your seed in the blue envelopes. Now, next week, we're going to be doing things a little different in the morning devotions and evening services. I'm doing morning devotions every night next week, or every morning next week. But next week in the evening services will be our branch pastors. Are we still here? It's missions weekend next weekend, and we want to honor these branch pastors. We want you to see how they're growing and developing and how God is using them. Amen? All right, in the balcony, we have the baskets out. In the parking lots, our ushers will serve those of you in the cars. Here on the ground floor, south, east, north, main, Bulacan, Pampanga, and Cavite, come. Bring your tithe and your seed before the Lord.
Amen and amen. Let's all stand up and may ask all our wonderful ushers in all of the campuses to help us. And let's stretch out our hands and let us pray. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful, Father, once again, that you're opening always, Lord, the windows of heaven and pouring out blessings, Father, unto your people. Thank you so much, likewise, Father, for the teaching of the word tonight. Thank you, Lord God, that we have the spiritual legacy, and we pray that it will continue, Father, for our next generation. And we are so grateful, Father, for the reminder that, Lord, as fathers, as parents, we will continue, Father, to be reliable, and likewise, Father, doing what's right and be sincere. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for tonight, that we can be able, Lord, and have the opportunity, Father, to honor you, Lord God, with the wealth that you have blessed us. Father, we thank you, God, for the tithes, Lord, and likewise, Father, for the seeds that you have supplied, Lord, seeds to the sowers, Father, so that, Lord, we can be able to sow seeds into your kingdom. May we ask, Father, for the rain of the Holy Spirit to be poured onto all the seeds, and it will grow and produce a financial harvest. Father, receive these gifts. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Let's all be seated this week at COP.
This week at COP, we have been wrapping up some incredible summer music training with far-reaching classes. Our basic music classes saw over 400 students from 150 churches nationwide. CAD staff and pastors held twice-a-week classes in various music theory and applied subjects, including dance. Participants were blessed and testify not only about the knowledge they gained, but also their renewed passion for ministry. Our dance classes have concluded for our 2021 summer workshop. We thank Brother Anchi and our hardworking creative ministry execs for ministering to so many churches in this way. This week at COP, praise God for souls saved this week. From the preteens, 77 preteens were saved in online classroom evangelism. District 6 saw a total of 67 souls saved, with some already attending service last Sunday. District 11 saw 23 saved. Our mighty men in uniform saw 60 saved this week in various outreaches. This week at COP, with Father's Day last week, we missed mentioning our dedications, but we do want to rejoice with our brothers and sisters for their harvest from the Lord. Are you ready? Let's go! We have dedicated cars to the Lord. The Chua family dedicated both a car and a motorcycle. Sister Kate dedicated her Toyota Rush. All the way from COP Hawaii, Brother Renee dedicated his Kia to the Lord. Father and son ushers Jojo and Isaac dedicated their red Toyota Yaris. From COP Dubai, Ryan and Rosanna dedicated their 2022 Captiva. Doctora Katrina of East dedicated her new Toyota Vios. The Sadwani family is praising God for the dedication of their Geely 2021 Urban Plus. Sister Janet, a choir and connect leader, and Brother Mahesh, who's an usher, testify of twofold restoration. The family had COVID and spent Christmas and New Year last year at home sick. They prayed, sowed a seed, and believed God for twofold restoration. And now they are overwhelmed with the blessings that are flowing in their lives. Not only a brand new car, but also a brand new house in Cavite. All glory to God. From East Campus, April Lynn and Ian dedicated their Chevrolet Orlando. Charmaine and Jomar, their Nissan. Paul Montana, a new Kia. The Pasquale family, their new Toyota. Look who's dedicated motorcycles to the Lord, Jamar Casa of East Campus. The Arellano family from Tondo has a triple dedication of motorcycles. Ramil Plaza of District 6, along with his nephew Alan, dedicated their motorcycles to the Lord as they attended Fortress 91. We have also had business dedications. The De Los Santos family, who recently opened their hardware business in North Caloocan, have now opened another branch in Na'i. The mobile fruit and veggie stand of Usher Chona Galzote came all the way to COP for its dedication. Sister Dana dedicated her newly opened aesthetic clinic. From East, Paul Montana dedicated their new bakery. And And we have had house dedications. The Pinlock family dedicated their house. The Roperos family dedicated their home. And from the MMU, Edith Marcello dedicated their new house to the Lord. And finally, coming up at COP, a reminder that this very Saturday, July 3, our youth service known as Salt and Light, or SNL, is going live at the main auditorium from 1:30 to 3 p.m. This will be interactive in all COP Manila campuses, so young people age 18 above, get to your campus and get ready for the joy of the Lord. It has been another great week at COP.
Amen, amen. We are about to have our second of our three prayer times tonight, and this particular prayer is going to be a prayer for financial security. So we are going to read Psalm 62, verses 1 and 2. It says, "My soul finds rest in God alone. My salvation comes from Him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will never be shaken." If we look at the first few verses of this psalm, we will see that word alone four times as David emphasizes that our security is in God and in God alone. And then David entrusted this song to Jeduthun, who was the chief musician in Gibeon, where the tabernacle was. Excuse me. And he was supposed to teach it to the people and let them sing it. Now, verses 1 and 2, "My soul finds rest in God alone," that is exactly the same, word for word, almost, as later on, verses 5 and 6. So because the Psalms are songs which are being sung, we can say that verse 1 and 2, verse 5 and 6, that is the chorus. That's the repeating part. That's the thing that you want to hum on your way home. It's the thing that you want to get inside people. We want people to realize and understand that our security is in God alone. And in Him, it says, "I will never be shaken." Being shaken is quite the opposite of being secure. And our security comes from Him alone. Now in verse 10, David brings it home to the area of finances. And he said, "Though your riches increase, do not set your heart on them, because God alone is worthy of our trust." Now, if you went to Israel with us, which I hope you will one of these times when we all get to go back there, yeah, we go to one of the pagan cities called Beth Shan, and it's kind of partway between Jerusalem and going up north to Galilee, and you can see this pagan city. And in that city, hundreds of years after the time of Jesus, there had been an earthquake that had destroyed the city, and all the pillars were falling over, and everything was buried. But apparently, that earthquake had some kind of warning. I don't know what it was. Maybe it was some tremors that were building up and building up, but the people had some kind of warning. How do we know that? Because there were no skeletons. When they started doing the archaeological dig, they found pillars and buildings and pottery and all kinds of things. Well, actually, they only found one skeleton in the whole city of Beth Shan. And that one skeleton was a guy who was found all those years, hundreds of years later, with his hand inside a clay jar of coins. Oh no, that's a guy who had set his heart on riches. That's a guy that everybody else was getting to a place of security, and for some reason he said, but wait a minute, I know where Tito keeps his coins. I'm going back. And just at that moment, everything, it's not worth it to set your heart on riches, because ultimately our financial security is not in our jar of coins. It's not in our bank account. Ultimately, our financial security, our security in every area of life, is in God alone. Now, there is a very familiar verse. When I tell you this verse, I know you know it. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5 says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Everybody say that. I will never leave you.
I will never leave you.
Nor forsake you.
Nor forsake you.
Say it all together. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Say it again.
I will never leave you nor forsake you.
Isn't that a wonderful verse? Yeah. It is a verse that for millennia has brought comfort and encouragement to so many people. I'm sure you've been encouraged by the verse, but a lot of people don't set that verse into its own context, because the full verse, chapter 13, verse 5, says, keep your life free from the love of money and be content with what you have. For, or because, he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. You see, that's the context of that verse. You don't need to reach for the money. You don't need to go for scams and schemes and shenanigans. You know, these things that you get on your messenger where somebody is scamming and scheming, and can I just have 1,000 pesos? Can you send it to my account? You don't need to resort to schemes and scams and shenanigans. You don't need to reach for the money. You don't need to worry about financial security if the Lord your God is with you. Because the Lord your God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills, and it is truly said of him that the whole earth is his. It all belongs to him. Amen. So our financial security is in God and God alone. And so in Psalm 62, which we started off reading, in verse 8, David says, trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart to him. For God is our refuge. Amen? So let's all stand up together. We are talking about psalms that we sing and psalms that we pray. So we are going to pray right now for financial security. And we will find our financial security in God. Amen. So we're going to pray for ourselves, our families, and our loved ones. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much because you and you alone are our God. You and you alone are our righteousness. You and you alone are who provides for us according to your riches and glory through Christ Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege of knowing you. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege of knowing you. Touching what God is doing and letting heaven fill our hearts. Heaven fill our lives. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness. go to our last prayer for the night, we prayed for safety, we prayed for financial security, and now we're going to pray for rest. Who could use some rest? I think so, because it is a pandemic. We find ourselves in situations where, yes, we could use some rest. So we're actually going to go back again to Psalm 62, just that first little phrase. My soul finds rest in God alone. During this pandemic, we are seeing cases of troubled hearts, of anxiety. We are seeing people who are out of work. Not everybody at COP is out of work. In fact, a lot of the people at COP are testifying of promotions and being sustained and promoted in their companies and retained when everybody else is being retrenched. But we see so many lines for transport. Have you noticed the lineups for public transportation? They are so long. And it takes, to get to the same place, now takes more rides, and each one of those rides is more expensive. So people have anxiety for so many reasons. They're trying to help their kids with their modules. I think one of the things that brings anxiety and restlessness in a pandemic is that we never know when our barangay is going to be locked down, right? That is very tiring. We don't know when our condo building or our barangay is going to be locked down. But if we need rest, we know where to find it. Because just as our safety is in God alone, and just as our financial security is in God alone, so our rest is in God alone. Amen. David just says it. My soul finds rest in God alone. Boom. Period. That's it. That is not to be debated. Our rest will be found in God alone. Jesus said, "Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." But you know, in the middle of trouble, when people are frantic, sometimes they run in the wrong direction for their solutions. In Psalm 55, there's a case of David in that situation. It says in verse 2, "My thoughts trouble me, and I am distraught." All right, it's a troubling time for David. He has an overwhelmed heart. What did he do? In verse 7, it says, "I said, oh, that I had the wings of a dove. I would fly away and be at rest." That is such a common way of thinking, but such a false way of thinking. You know, if I could just get to New Zealand, I could have some rest. If I could just go to Japan, I could have some rest. If I could just fly away, if I could just leave here and fly there, I would find some rest. And people struggle more and more until they realize that rest does not come from the place you are in. Rest comes from the God you are in. And he is in us and we are in him. Amen. And our rest comes from him. And there is a really, really great reason for us to find our rest in the Lord. Psalm 116, verse 7 says, "Be at rest once more, O my soul, for the Lord has been good to you." Amen. The Lord has been what?
Good.
The Lord has been?
Good.
Anybody here, the Lord has been good to you?
Amen.
Amen. So therefore, be at rest once more, O my soul. Now, the very fact that you have to say once more, of course, that means that there is a period of time where maybe your heart is troubled. Maybe when you first hear something, you think, oh, what does that mean? What's going on? But be at rest once more, O my soul, because the Lord has been
good.
The Lord has been
good.
good to us. You know, there's this amazing truth in the Bible that we are in Him, He is in us. We rejoice in Him, He rejoices in us. We are His portion, He is our portion. And here we find one of those truths as well about rest. Our rest is in God alone, but God's rest is in us. In Psalm 132, verse 14. Sorry, my mask keeps going up into my eyes. Psalm 132, verse 14. This is my resting place forever. Here I will sit enthroned, for I have desired it. It is something that God wants. God wants to find His rest in you.
Amen.
So if you could just think, what is your most comfortable at-home place in the whole world? What is that place? Maybe it's a favorite chair that you sit in at home. And when you get to sit in that chair, you go, ah, I can forget about the day. Now I'm sitting in, or maybe it's a favorite tree that you get to sit under and you get to just be, I can sit here in this fresh air under this tree, I can read a book, and that's your place. Well, you know what? If you were to ask God, God, what is your most comfortable place in the whole world where you feel at home? You know what God would say? In you.
Amen.
That's where He can rest. He takes His rest in us. So we find our rest in Him. He finds His rest in us. But our rest, just like our safety, just like our security, it is in God alone. And we can say, be at rest once more, O my soul, for the Lord has been
good
to you. Isn't that true? All right, so let's all stand up, all the people that the Lord has been good to. We have our final prayer tonight. We are going to pray for rest. And we have learned that rest doesn't mean necessarily that you go take a nap. Sometimes rest is relaxing in the Lord. Amen. And realizing you can cast all your burdens on Him, for He cares for you. Be at rest once more, O my soul, for the Lord has been
good
to you. Amen. So let's pray for ourselves, our families, and our loved ones, and let's pray for rest.
Amen.
Let's pray. Lord, we thank
Lord,
you for
Jesus,
being
Jesus,
so
Lord,
awesome. So great, Lord.
So great,
Lord. You alone,
thank you.
turn around and reach and get your communion right now, wherever it is? Pastor Marlon showed me earlier today a communion that came from our very own machine. He and his team are starting to prepare that for us. Pretty soon we'll see it in our services. But for right now, let's hold our communion. Let's take the bread. The night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he gave thanks to God for it. And he said, "Take it and eat it. This is my body which was broken for you." And as often as you do this, you remember my death until I come again. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for the body that was broken for us. Thank you, Lord, for our salvation. Thank you, Father, that you took all the pain and suffering that we need not. But we can cry out to you, and you hear us, and you answer our prayers. And Lord, healing is ours. Salvation is ours. Thank you, Lord, for all that you have done with your crucifixion. In Jesus' name, let's partake of the bread together. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks. And he said, "You need to do this often. And when you do it in remembrance of me, you're proclaiming my death until I come again." And so tonight, we're going to partake the cup together, and we're going to thank God. Lord, we thank you so much for your blood that was shed for us for the remission of sin. Lord, we thank you that we are justified as if, Lord, we've never sinned. We have right standing with you. When we see you in heaven, we will not shrink back as those that need to be ashamed, but we will confidently bow before you, Lord, forever and ever, singing of the blood of the Lamb that was slain for us. We thank you for it, Lord, in Jesus' name. Let's partake the cup together.
All my life you have been
campus pastors to come and pray for us. Thank you, Pastor Marlon.
Amen. Let's all pray. Lord, we thank you so much for your word, O God, that we received this evening. Thank you, God, for encouraging us. Thank you, Lord God, that, Lord, we can look at the book of Psalms right now, O God, and Lord, we can sing and we can pray. We thank you, God, for, Lord, your will, O God, is for us to be safe. Your will, O God, is for us to really have financial stability. And Lord, that you want the rest, O God, for our souls. We thank you, Lord, and we give you praise, O God, tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless everyone. See you again next week.